Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. On today's show, one of my heroes, Will Durst, not just a hero in comedy, just a hero in life. The New York Times calls him quite possibly the greatest political satirist working today. And we'll get to him in a second. I got a couple of things that I want to go over with you. First of all, thank you all for indulging me while I was away. I am, well, it's on. You can watch the show. Hulu. Everybody go subscribe to Hulu. It's a streaming video service. It's kind of like Netflix. It's, I don't know, $5 a month or $11 a month if you don't want the commercials. The Triumph 2016 election special is now airing on Hulu. 90 minutes of pure comedy. Triumph the insult comic dog tailed the candidates in New Hampshire, in South Carolina, and Iowa. And I think it's some of the funniest political satire on television right now. Triumph the insult comic dog, he's 20 years, he still has it. So that's on Hulu. I'm going to be at the Creek in the Cave in... What, Alex, where is the Creek in the Cave? It's Long Island City. It's the first stop off the 7. Okay. The Creek in the Cave. Go to thecreekinthecave.com. February 17th through the 21st at 7 p.m. Listen to this lineup. David Feldman, Frank Conniff, and John Fugelsang. February 17th through the 21st at the Creek in the Cave at 7 p.m. I think the tickets are either $5 or $10. We'll find out by the end of the show. What a great evening of comedy that is. Me, John Fugelsang, and Frank Conniff. Go to creekinthecave.com and buy tickets and come see that show. Also want to thank Sean L. McCarthy for filling in for me last week, and Frank Conniff also filled in for me last week. They did such a great job. We finally figured out what was wrong with this show, and the answer is I. That's the problem with the show. Less David Feldman. Joining us from San Francisco is Will Durst. Hello, Mr. Durst.
How you doing, David? Sounds like fun. Creek at the Cave.
TheCreekInTheCave.com. And when you come out to New York, we'll have to do a show with you. Yeah, you're doing Elect to Laugh 2016 at a theater near you. That's a one-man show.
Right. And it's about 80 minutes, me, my little overhead projector, and I'm hitting clubs and theaters all around the country. I'm going to be in Minneapolis in a couple of weeks. I'll be in Tahoe next week. So.
Are you at Acme? Are you at Acme?
Yeah.
Acme in Minneapolis. Say hello to Lewis Lee for me, one of the greatest clubs in the world. Are you going to be working with Howie Knave in Lake Tahoe?
Yeah, I am indeed at the Lake Tahoe Improv at Harrah's.
And how was Zany's in Chicago?
Zany's went well. We had a great time, and it was the week before the Iowa caucuses, so the political-minded crowds did come out.
Well, today is Tuesday, and the people of New Hampshire are going to the polls. Let's discuss this. What do you think?
Well,
go ahead.
New Hampshire is hard to figure out. You know that phrase, thinking outside the box? Well, the box they're talking about is New Hampshire.
Well,
they don't call it the Granite State for nothing.
The granite is the rocks in their head. These people.
And also it's tiny. It's tiny and it's really, really white.
It's white, and there's a nice Jeffersonian aesthetic to New Hampshire. Feels like what America used to be, right? You've been around New Hampshire.
Yeah. If you like the 50s, yeah.
They're good, decent people. I don't know what I talked to you about last time you were on the show. I was in Keene, New Hampshire. I went to a you know, with this Triumph Phoenix Cell Comic Dog special, we went after all the candidates. We went to a lot of the rallies. And I went to a Keene, New Hampshire country club, very wealthy part of New Hampshire, and Jeb Bush was speaking there. And I get it. I get why people of that ilk vote the way they do. If I were white and privileged and here first, I would want to ease into change. I wouldn't want it that quickly. I kind of get where these people are coming from. I think they're wrong, but I get it. Don't you?
Well, also, they're so isolated. I mean, it is, you know, communities do have to stand up for themselves because they're not near. I mean, they're near Boston, you know, but that's still an hour away. So especially, you know, you get outside of Keene and Nashua and Manchester and, you know, you get to the anything north of Concord, you know. It's you know, man versus the elements. So you got to be tough, and in order to be tough, you don't want to give stuff away. So I understand their kind of selfish objectivism.
Well, but then you're going to Minneapolis, which is a hotbed of liberalism, where the weather is equally tough, and the people in Minneapolis all concluded, well, if the elements are harsh, we all have to work together. And share.
Yeah. Also, they have a huge university there, you know, and universities have a lot to do with advanced generosity and thinking and you know, and sharing. And, you know, they have a lot of cultural amenities as well, museums and hospitals and libraries and. So people see that as, you know, something for the whole community and something that everybody should get a little bit of.
Yeah. I was watching John Sununu, who was the governor of New Hampshire, Republican at one time, and then he became the first George Bush's chief of staff. W had to come in and fire him, I believe. But, you know, this guy, he was actually saying that President Obama is purposely destroying the country, not accidentally, but purposely destroying the country. Do you?
Yeah, that's one of the problems with the Republican message this time around. You know, it doesn't really resonate. I mean, people hate Obama because, well, Republicans have always been taking out Democrats. You know, Obama isn't just responsible for. You know, the deterioration of American society as we know it, but he's also, you know, responsible for the substandard maple syrup crop in Vermont and sugar mites and dengue fever and all badness throughout history in perpetuity through the universe. I mean, that's just the stance. And, you know, the economy's doing okay. Unemployment is down. You know, terrorism, of course, is always going to be a problem. That's never, you know, they don't really have a message that resonates outside of their base. So it's going to be tough for them.
Yeah. I mean, Rubio, during the last debate, four times said, let's dispel of this notion that President Trump. He said
six
it six times? Really?
Six times, yes. He said it five times, and people were just shaking their heads, and then he rephrased it a sixth time.
I thought it was only, wow. Let's dispel this notion that Barack Obama doesn't know what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. And it's kind of what Rubio is saying. Sununu is saying, and that is that President Obama is purposely ruining America.
It sounds like it was a talking point that went out in some fax machine, because I'm sure they're still using fax.
Finally, somebody is criticizing Bernie Sanders. We don't know that much about him. And there was an article in the New York Times that when he was head of, I guess it was the Veterans Affairs Committee, when the Democrats had control of the Senate, he ignored worries and warnings about the condition of the VA. He said, this is like, I guess, 4 years ago, these calls about how the VA is letting the veterans down are not worthy of looking into. And I understand why Bernie Sanders was saying that, because the Republicans do want to destroy the VA. The Republicans do want to destroy the federal government so they can prove that the federal government doesn't work and that the states are the laboratories of democracy and our taxes should be lower. And the VA at one time, 10 years ago, before George Bush got his hands on it, the VA was a shining example of socialized medicine. The VA used to be as popular as Medicare is. It worked. The VA worked. And then George W. Bush became president and the sequester went into effect a few years later, and the VA started screwing up. So I understand why Bernie Sanders, when he was chairman of the Veterans Affairs Committee a couple of years ago, said, I don't believe that there are problems at the VA. It's just the Republicans trying to prove that the federal government can't do anything right. But how could Rubio, how can Sununu claim that Obama, who believes in big government, would be purposely be trying to destroy big government? That's what the Democrats believe in. It makes absolutely no sense to me.
Doesn't have to.
Yeah.
As long as you attack him and a couple of people. See, if you attack him 10 different ways and you gain two different people for each of the 10 different ways that you attack him, and people go, yeah, that's right. Doesn't matter if number three and number eight, you know, cancel each other out. It doesn't matter if they say diametrically opposed things, because you're just going for those two people that each attack is going for.
You and I have been doing political satire longer than the two of us can remember. Not because we've been doing it for a long time. I think we're both senile. I can remember opening for you at the other cafe the night Lloyd Benson debated Dan Quayle. This must have been 1988. And
must have been.
Yes.
It was probably October of 1988.
Not 1998, 1988.
No, 1988, yeah.
And that was the night, I remember you were headlining, I was middling, other cafe, I remember the fog. And that was the night Lloyd Benson nailed Quayle for comparing himself to John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Quayle, about the same age Rubio is right now, and Quayle was saying, you know, I have spent just as much time in the Senate as JFK did, and Lloyd Benson said, I knew John Fitzgerald Kennedy, you're no John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Dan Quayle was pretty stupid, wasn't he?
No, he was a politician from, you know, Indiana, and he was fine in Indiana, and he had charmed his way to this position, and suddenly they're playing heavy-duty hardball with him. I mean, he never had to play hardball before, you know. He used his kind. So, no, he wasn't that stupid. You can't be stupid to be a U.S. senator. Bush isn't stupid. Bush is just... he relies on his instincts, you know, and his instincts were wrong because of how he grew up. But
which Bush are you talking about? Billy Bush? Which
one? No. I was talking about George. But yeah, Jeb is actually, you know, poor Jeb, you know. Jeb! Exclamation mark. What's your last name? It doesn't matter. I'm Jeb. Full of excitement.
Yeah, he's the smart Bush, right?
Yeah, that's what they keep saying. No, this is the smart one. Well, thanks. You know, thanks for giving us the smart one the third time around.
Well, if he was smart, he would have changed his name.
Well, he tried to. He tried to convince people that he was adopted. Didn't work.
And now he's got his brother, W, endorsing him.
You know, I wouldn't count Bush out. You know, he's got the money. He's got the PACs. Got the donors. I just don't, you know, you know how they always say that generals are fighting the last war?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think Bush is debating he's running the last campaign. You know, I mean, this would have been a great campaign. he had run against Romney 4 years ago. But Donald Trump has changed, you know, the whole Tea Party thing, and Donald Trump is hooked into that, and he's at these debates, and Trump is like a Tyrannosaurus Rex, you know, chomping on people and spitting out pieces of red meat. And you look over at Jeb Bush, and he wants the teacher to control the bully, and he can barely break the crust of his creme brulee.
By the way, generals fight the last war, and wives fight the last war. How many times do you have to say to your wife, "No, that's your father. That was your father did that. That was the war that, you know, the first 17 years of your life. This is a different war. This is my leaving a dish in the sink. This is a different war." Yeah, I would like to thank Mr. Trump for, if he wins tonight, and I hope he does win. I hope he gets wins the primary in New Hampshire, for reasons I'll get into in a second. But I'd like to thank him for finally making it settled law that the Bush name is synonymous with failure, that it's disgraceful to even think that a Bush is entitled to sit in the Oval Office. Right? I mean, shouldn't we thank Trump for a couple of things?
Well, Trump is right on a couple of things. One, if he gets elected, Mexico indeed will build a wall.
Yes.
To control our immigration. And two.
And they'll pay for it.
And they'll pay for it, yeah. And two, you know, he says that he's a big fan of Christianity, and if he gets elected, people are going to start praying like you wouldn't believe.
Yeah, I'm holding off on getting to Trump because I feel I owe it to my listeners to talk about the other candidates who tonight. I want to ask you who you think is going to win tonight. I'm worried that you're right. I am worried that Jeb might actually squeak this out because he has spent more on TV advertising in New Hampshire than all the other candidates combined.
I'll tell you who the guy to be afraid of is, if you're a Democrat, is Kasich. Mm-hmm. Kasich right now is the only guy who could beat Hillary.
I agree, 100%.
I think they could all beat Bernie. I think they would all beat Bernie, but Kasich is the only guy that could beat Hillary.
Yeah. I want to talk about Bernie in a second because I'm about to endorse him. My listeners will, believe it or not, how long have you known me? Too long. We won't. But
over 30 years.
Yeah. Remember me, little towel-headed boy? Not towel.
Yeah, we're closing in on 34 years. 82.
But a couple of the listeners want to know who I am going to support, and I'm going to endorse Bernie later on in the show. Maybe I'll endorse him while I'm talking to you. I feel kind of pretentious actually endorsing somebody. But a lot of people have written in and saying you need to endorse Bernie. You need to tell your listeners.
Yeah, you got to officially go. See, I don't do that. I don't work for candidates. I work for causes. I work for a cause. I work for Planned Parenthood. I work for the Association for Retarded Citizens. I work for.
Oh, so you work for Republicans then? That's not fair.
I will if they have a good cause, yeah.
Oh, when you say you work for causes, I thought you meant cause, like his defense fund that you...
Oh, the Bill Cosby defense fund. Yeah. No, actually, yeah.
I'll get to Bernie in a second and why I support...
Okay, well, let's go through the other candidates.
Let's go through the other candidates.
What about Ted Cruz?
Well, let's get back to Kasich. I agree with you that he's the wonk Jeb pretends to be, right? And he's had a successful...
Yeah, but he's also... He looks like the... You know, he's... Rand Paul is the reluctant Republican. Yeah, but Kasich is a real guy. He just seemed reasonable in those debates.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we'll hang on... Forget Trump for a second. Rubio must be... on something that his brother-in-law used to deal, to think that he has a shot, right? I mean, this is just somebody who, I wouldn't even put him in as vice president. He's done, right? But his performance.
Rubio, no, I think he'd be a good vice president. I think the robotic thing would go away, you know, in 6 months when they have to. What is 6 months from today? August. Yeah, July is when they're going to pick the vice president. So he's got plenty of time.
I don't know. After that debate where Chris Christie ate his lunch and his dinner and his breakfast.
Christie. I mean, he's a former prosecutor, you know.
He was pretty good, though, wasn't he?
Yeah, yeah. But he's the same way even when he's addressing his supporters, you know. He always sounds like he's reading people their rights.
You ever have a day where you feel fat? You feel lousy? I mean, that's how Chris Christie feels every day. His thighs are chapped. His anus is burning. He's hungry all the time. He's angry. You know, when your clothes don't feel good, he feels that way. He feels lousy 24 hours a day. That's who Chris Christie is. I don't know what that means. I just figured I'd share that with you.
I appreciate it. I think he's destined to disprove the whole too big to fail thing.
He might do well tonight, right?
No.
Okay. Not a chance.
No, I don't. I think that's an illusion.
Okay.
I think he was his only participation in this election will be to have knocked Rubio out.
Yeah. And then there is Carly Fiorina. She's done.
Tougher than a $2 steak.
She's done, right?
Stick a fork in her. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's out after tomorrow.
I tried to stick a fork in her, but it went limp. That's a sexist thing. What's going to happen if Hillary becomes? Here's my fear. If Bernie gets elected, then the police are going to start shooting.
Elected.
I'm going straight to November. He's the new president.
Wow.
First Jewish president. Are we going to have a spate of police officers shooting unarmed Jewish men? That's my fear, because we have a black president now, and suddenly, for the first time in American history, unarmed black men are being shot by the police. This has never happened before, and I'm wondering if it's a reaction to a black. People keep saying to me, a black man was elected president, and look how horrible things got for black people. I go, what? They didn't get bad for, but they were always bad for black people.
Take cameras on them now.
Yeah. Although, you know, my theory about the body cams is that because they're on television, the police up their game. They become hot shots because the camera is rolling. So they, hello?
Yeah, I'm still with you.
It's offensive, but it's moderately amusing. If you are not the victim of police violence. What happens if Hillary gets elected president? Are women going to become insufferable? I'm serious.
Is that a syllogism based on your previous comment about black people and that women already are insufferable?
Are they going to become insufferable? Because
I ain't going there. But I would love to see Hillary and Carly Fiorina both nominated. Just to imagine the rednecks in the South going into the voting booth and having to choose between two women. Their little heads would pop right off.
I want to get back to women here for a second. I mean this. I'm a feminist. I agree with women. I think men are pigs, and I saw Chi-Rock, the new Spike Lee movie. Have you seen that?
Right.
Great movie, and it's about women having the power to control men, and rightfully so. It's Liz Estrada, basically. And there's a new Michael Moore documentary, Who Should We Invade Next? And the solution that Michael Moore has at the end of his documentary, is that women are the only ones who can save this planet. Men have destroyed it. And I agree. I think we need women to...
I totally agree. I think we've had 44 male presidents in a row. We should have 44 female presidents in a row. And then after 88, then we can mix it up a little bit.
Yeah. I honestly think that just being in an office with all men and that prison mentality, it's got to end. It's just the planet is suffocating. That being said, what I'm worried about is that women are angry, and they have every right to be angry. But we have to deal with them. They live with us, right? Some of us have, and my fear.
Well, it's the famous, you remember Emo Phillips' line, women, you can't live with them. You can't cut them up into little pieces and serve them on toast points as canapes.
So women, women are angry right now. They've done a new poll, and
And the poll reveals women are angry.
it vindicated everything I've been saying for the past 4 years. I've been saying for 4 years that women are angrier than they've ever been in the history of men and female relations. And I attribute this to the rat in the maze searching for the cheese, that there is a psychological study of rats and their tolerance of frustration. And the closer the rat gets to the cheese, the more frustrated he becomes when he can't get the cheese.
Wow.
Yeah. So if you create a maze and then there's this wall that separates the rat from the cheese, and he can smell it, but he can't get in there. It's kind of like the glass ceiling. The rat almost becomes psychotic. And I'm worried that if Hillary gets elected president, women, or rats, will think, they'll smell the cheese being equality, but they're not gonna get it, and they'll just become really, really angry at me, specifically.
At you.
At me, specifically.
Yeah. I think you should come up with a line of bumper stickers that say, smell the cheese.
Smell the cheese. And the other thing is that suppose they do get the cheese and they discover that it's pretty stinky cheese, that that what we've had for 40,000 years, pretty bad. You can have it. It comes with a lot of baggage, that cheese. And then they're going to be angry with us. They're going to say, well, you ruined the cheese.
Well, you misrepresented the cheese.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's why I guess what I'm saying is that's why I'm voting for Bernie Sanders.
Keep women smelling the cheese.
I don't think you want the cheese. And who smells more like cheese than Bernie Sanders? That's the point I'm making. Better you should smell the cheese and actually hold it in your hands, ladies. Well,
so you're saving women from disappointment by keeping them from actually achieving their goals.
Well, maybe in all seriousness.
I think that's smart. I think that's really smart.
Well, in all seriousness, there's a lot of anger in this country.
You see it on TV. Do you watch cable TV at all?
A little.
Have you seen all these shows are based on anger? They're all like women be fighting and shit,
Because nobody knows how to have a conversation without it turning into some adversarial relationship. People don't understand how to share ideas and share knowledge. It's a male thing. It's men showing off who knows more, who's more powerful. Don't you find that? That's what cable news is. Like, you and I are actually having a conversation. I'm not trying to establish dominance over you. Hello?
Well, but it's implied dominance because it's your show.
Yeah. And I wish...
So I'm here to assist you. Okay. I understand that. I know my role.
All right, let's get to Trump.
It's the top of my palate. What?
Let's get to Trump. Tonight.
What about him?
New Hampshire.
He wins.
I hope so. Don't you?
By 12 points. Who comes in second? Four choices. Cruz, Rubio, Kasich, or Bush?
It's either Kasich or Bush. I think it's going to be Kasich.
I think it's going to be Bush.
Well, I think people are going to move the pen to Bush because they've seen all those ads. And then they're going to see Kasich, and they're going to say, you know what? Kasich's kind of like Bush, but only better. And they're going to pick.
Well, you're right on that.
Yeah. Okay, and now let's turn to the Democrats.
South Carolina?
No, let's get to Hillary and Bernie.
Well, Bernie obviously wins.
By how much? Because she's cut it. At one point, he was ahead.
9 points. Because she needs to get it to single digits. So just like she needed to win last week, and she won by 0.26%. This week, she cuts it to single digits, but just the bare minimum of single digits.
And then we go to South.
Points.
Okay, and what happens if Trump doesn't win tonight and he disappears? Conceivable. I don't think a lot of his voters are registered or even know how to read a ballot box, a ballot. What happens if you get some establishment candidate in the Republican Party, somebody like Kasich or Jeb? Then the Democrats become the spectacle, right? You have the socialist Jew from Brooklyn, and the Democrats are suddenly, are they the laughing stock the way the Republicans are now with Trump? Can a socialist Jew from Brooklyn get the nomination from a party that whose president is Barack Hussein Obama? I mean, how insane is it to think that America could elect Bernie Sanders after we elected a black guy whose middle name was Hussein?
Well, you got to feel bad for Hillary. I mean, first she loses to a charismatic young black man. Now she's going to lose to a charismatic old white guy. You know, I mean, what does she need to do? Poor baby. But I think Bernie has too many soft spots that the Republicans can hit him on. You know, I just can't see him winning Ohio and Pennsylvania.
I mean, other than the fact that he has a child out of wedlock, he's been married twice, and he's an atheist and a Jew and a self-avowed socialist.
And a conscientious objector.
And a conscientious objector. Other than that, why would he be unpalatable to the people of Alabama?
Exactly.
But
you know, he can extol his experience. I mean, when you think about it, when history starts to repeat itself, he'll be the first to know. He can alert the rest of us. You know, he's only a year older than Mick Jagger.
What?
Yeah. Wow. And he's a year younger than Charlie Watts, the drummer for the Stones. He's a year younger than Charlie Watts. And they're going on tour. They're doing a South American tour this year. So.
He's a year older than Mick Jagger?
Yeah.
Wow. He looks so much better than Mick Jagger. Have you ever seen Mick Jagger up... close? It's like talking to one of the trees from The Wizard of Oz. It's just all creases. And yet every woman would go to
That's
bed with
terrible.
Him. Every woman yeah. would go to bed with Mick Jagger. Hey, does Bernie have charisma? You said he has charisma. Does he?
It's kind of a fossilized charisma. kind of like charisma, you know, like classic charisma. You know, it's not permeable. It's pretty crystallized.
When women, when you say charisma, does that mean women want to bed him?
Oh, I don't know about that. I'm not a woman.
I mean, do you think women want to get into bed with him and attend to his bed?
I don't know. Bed sores, I would not want to hazard a guess. I would not want to impugn or even try to plumb the mind of the American woman.
I think most women want to give him a sponge bath and then turn him over.
Burp him. I don't know. All I know is that women stopped wanting to bed me about 20 years ago.
Women find you attractive. I wish I could figure out what it is. Like growing up, I was told it was the penis, and then they changed the rules, and then it's our butts. The women are turned on by our butts. Did you know that?
No, I had no idea.
You didn't know that? They're doing to us.
No, but I always had a big dick, so I was always okay on that one. And then they had, of course, they changed it. Yeah.
They're like, they do to us what we do to them, which is, you know.
Change the rules.
They change the rules on us. I cannot figure out.
Yeah, but you think about how breasts have evolved. And, you know, just when, you know, the 50s and 60s, big breasts were in, and then they developed a way to have big breasts for women who didn't have them, mm-hmm. and they made those available, and then they were dangerous and life-threatening. And then suddenly, you know, the svelte, the 13-year-old boy look came back in, you know, so all these women who had huge breasts must have kind of felt betrayed. And,
I love talking politics with you, Will Durst. So here's why I'm voting for Bernie Sanders, and why I want our listeners in New Hampshire to go vote for Bernie today. I listened to some of his speeches. Most of you were watching the Super Bowl, I got on YouTube and just looked up some speeches of Bernie and finally got around to listening to him. And I remember really liking him 15 years ago, 10 years ago, but thinking, yeah, we need a guy like this in the House of Representatives. We need a guy like this in the Senate. We need somebody from Vermont to remind us what's important. I never thought he would catch on with the entire country. I just thought that was impossible. But as long as people want him, enough people seem to want him, I'm not going to...
Well, you know the old phrase, the political axiom, that Republicans fall in line and Democrats fall in love.
Mm-hmm.
And Hillary is not lovable. I mean, you know, trying to make her cuddly, it's like gluing goose down to the side of a barracuda. She's as huggable as Margaret Thatcher. Now.
Yeah.
And that phony laugh, I go to YouTube and I get recordings of her laughing and I use it to degrout my bathroom tile. You know, that's perfect.
By the way, it's sexist to comment on the way a woman sounds. Did you know that?
Really?
Yep. I was just reading about that. Not only you cannot comment on the way they look, that's sexist. You cannot comment on their tone of voice, that's sexist. We're one step away from not being able to comment on the way they think. That'll be sexist.
What about the fact that female politicians obviously have had facelifts, whereas male politicians, I can't tell. What about that? Can I mention that?
You
Carly Fiorina, Jesus Christ, lady, you know, your eyes are tilted now. I mean, you know, they go up at the ends. one more facelift, she's going to have a goatee. Remember that line?
Yeah, and I actually have a joke that I'm going to apologize for that I came up with that I should.
A preemptory apology?
Uh-huh. Carly Fiorina has had so many facelifts, her belches smell like a queef. Now, that's an example of a joke.
That's funny if you know what queef is.
That's an example of a joke that should not be told ever in public, and I would never tell that joke.
No, but here on a podcast.
I didn't tell that joke. We're going to cut that out because it's inappropriate. We're discussing politics, Will Durst. I'm discussing politics with a man that the New York Times calls possibly the greatest political satirist working today in America.
Even they qualified it, yeah.
Yeah, otherwise I wouldn't have mentioned it. The only reason I mentioned that blurb about you is it has the word possibly in it. My ego can only hold so much. Go ahead. What about New Hampshire?
No. What happens after New Hampshire? Oh, did we cover Bernie? Are you?
Well, I want to get back to Bernie because I sense, Will Durst, because you like me are a victim of your own expertise and you want to think about what's possible as opposed to dream. You're kind of just saying, let's just get this over with and put Hillary in the Oval Office, right? As a closeted liberal, am I exposing your politics? But I would assume you're kind of going, Hillary. Is that a fair statement?
Oh, I don't care who gets it. I just like observing.
Okay.
I really don't. Be interesting if yeah.
But people of our age say things like, okay, it's nice to dream about Bernie. Yes, he's right. Everything he says is right, but let's be realistic. And I was realistic up until I saw this groundswell of, you know, obviously he's tapping into something, and why not? Why not? Since when do we have to be realistic in America? I mean, supposedly we've invented all these great things. Why do we have to be realistic? Why not get Bernie Sanders in there? And by the way,
only because the next president may appoint 4 Supreme Court justices. I think that's why.
And you don't think Bernie would elect somebody, nominate somebody to the Supreme Court who's pro-choice?
Here's the thing. You know the old 1% doctrine that Cheney used to operate under? If there's a 1% possibility of it happening, then you act upon it as if it is real. And that's what there was a book written about that.
Ron Suskind.
And yes. And the same thing is true with Hillary. If Hillary has a 35% chance of winning the presidency against whoever the Republicans nominate, and Bernie has a 34% chance, I think you go with Hillary.
Yeah, yeah. I understand that. But I think things are so screwed up right now. Well, I don't know. Right now, if it's New Hampshire, you go, I would have said the same thing about Barack Obama. I did say the same thing about Barack Obama.
I did, too. I thought Hillary was going to win the nomination, and I thought McCain was going to win the election. And I was wrong.
And didn't you say, old man, and didn't I say, old man, America doesn't deserve Barack Obama? We've been a bad country, and we need somebody like Hillary to come in there and crack some skulls and get this country on the right path before we treat ourselves to the dessert of Barack Obama. That's what I said 8 years ago. I was wrong. I think Barack Obama.
Yeah, I think that he's been a pretty good president, but I think he's also been handicapped by the outcry and the nativism and the people who, you know, just could never accept the fact that we were being governed by a black guy who lived in public housing. And the fact that the whole Tea Party thing emboldened conservatives and the safe house districts, and they didn't have to work with them. And I think they would have worked with Hillary more, because she knew more.
Well, but the seeds of the hatred for Barack Obama were already planted and had already sprouted under Bill Clinton. They shut down the government with Bill Clinton. They impeached
Bill Clinton. They hated Clinton, too. The Republicans, the conservatives have, you know, they've streamlined their anti-incumbency project. I mean, they're wonderful shadow government people in that, you know, they did it with Carter. They did it with Kennedy. They couldn't do it with Johnson because the country was behind, you know, after the fallen president. But, I mean, you think about it, they did it with Roosevelt. You know, they fire up the conservatives because conservatives is all black and white, you know. Unfortunately, liberals deal with nuance, you know, which is not as easy to put on a bumper sticker. So, I mean, you look at our history, and they hated Roosevelt so bad. We don't even know because we weren't there, but they hated him so much. And then it was war, and then it was Truman, and they couldn't hate Truman because the war was still going on. Then Eisenhower, and then Kennedy, they hated him, and came, you know, the John Birchers, and then it was Lyndon Johnson, but he had stuff on him, and then they hated, you know, then it was Nixon, and then Ford, and then Jimmy Carter, and they hated him, and they almost shut down the government because nobody would work with Carter. And then it was 8 years of Reagan and then 4 years of Bush. And then they hated Clinton. And they hated him dead one. Bob Dornan called for his impeachment on January 21st, 1993. So they just hate him. Just hate for 8 years. And then they had Bush for 8 years. And then we don't think that he's a good president. See, look what he did with Katrina. And then Obama. And they hate. So it doesn't matter who gets hit.
Hatred feels good, doesn't it? Feels good to hate. It does. I remember it.
You understand my thesis?
Yes, I do. I do.
You agree with it?
I disagree with two things. One is, I think that Jimmy Carter was destroyed more by Tip O'Neill and the Ted Kennedy branch of the Democratic Party than he was by the Republicans. I know that Ted Kennedy really hated Jimmy Carter the minute Jimmy took office, and Tip O'Neill kind of helped with that. The other thing is, you know, we always say...
No, I agree with you there, because Carter came in with this anti-Washington mandate. It was right after Watergate, and he came in with his little Georgia boys, you know, Burt Lance and all those guys, and he said, well, we came in here, we're not going to work with you because Washington is corrupt, and they said, yeah, try to get anything done. But it wasn't just Republicans, but the Democrats didn't help.
Yeah. I'm old enough to remember my parents not liking Jimmy Carter because he wasn't a real liberal. You know, we always think of Jimmy Carter as the quintessential liberal, but he wasn't. There were other, you know, Humphrey was more of a liberal than Jimmy Carter back then. The other thing you said that is true, but I just want to push back a little on it, and that is that the Republicans don't understand nuance. I think we're seeing a much more vigorous debate in the Republican Party than we're seeing in the Democratic Party. I mean, you know, you have guys like Rand Paul who are going after the NSA, and the Republican debates are pretty substantive in a way, sort of, kind of. There's nuance there, isn't there? Except for Trump and everybody else in the Republican Party, except for everybody. Maybe I'm wrong. Hey,
the government, the economy isn't doing that badly. right now.
Yes, it is.
You know, I mean, our infrastructure sucks and all sorts of things, you know, yeah, but that's what happens when you live in a house for a long time. But he said, looking around the rubble of his. You know, you listen to the Republicans and, oh, I hate Obama and, you know, oh, yeah, well, I hate him even more. Yeah, well, I hate him worse than chigger mites and footy pajamas, you know. So right now, that's the only thing that I'm getting out of the Republicans.
Well, I think
there's some internecine warfare. You're right. Rand Paul is a bit more, you know, isolationist and Trump says he wants to kill everybody. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, there's a little bit of that. But, you know, they all hate Obama.
The reason I'm endorsing Bernie is because of the economy. Yes, we're below 5% with the unemployment. And that's considered full employment. Economists agree that once you get below 5%, the economy's humming along for the working man. But that's not really the way it is. I mean, when you look at the underemployed, then it's about 9.1%. And those jobs, most Americans, and this is why I think we have to elect Bernie, because here we have below 5% unemployment. The people who are working are miserable. There was a new study that was conducted by the British, but it speaks to what Americans are going through. The number one cause of unhappiness is being sick. Number two is going to work. Number two, and why is that? You know, we define ourselves in America by our jobs. And none of us have jobs. The thing that we get paid to do, none of us can say it makes us happy. We, especially for the baby boomers. I think the baby boomers were all fed this idea that, yeah, it's important to have a family, but you have to have a job, and the job you have will define you, and that job will make you walk upright and be proud. And we've been robbed. Baby boomers have been robbed of the pride that comes with a job. And in America, having a job is a privilege, not a right. And they own you. They own all your time, and they wring you dry. And that has to change. And that's because of Wall Street. That's because of corporate greed. It's because the guy wringing you dry is getting wrung dry by his board of directors. So we have to change the economic infrastructure in this country. And Bernie is the only one discussing that, really. And he's been talking about it for 20 years. The problem is Wall Street. The problem is greed, and it's a disrespect for workers. The people who make the big money have convinced us that we're all dispensable, and we are. Nobody's indispensable, including Wall Street. So I say get rid of the source. Everybody thinks, like I'm living in New York City, and I can remember the fear in New York City of what happens if we alienate Wall Street. What are we going to do? Well, you know, they've been alienating Wall Street for the past 8 years, and the city's doing just fine. You don't need Wall Street. It just sucks money out of the system. Wall Street doesn't create jobs. It makes the jobs you already have more painful. Bernie Sanders, yes, you know, he missed the boat on Black Lives Matters, but we've got a disease in this country, and it's the tip of Manhattan. It's the tip of Manhattan. It's Wall Street. And Bernie Sanders has been hitting that one note for 20 years, and he's right. And the reason most of us are miserable is we're underemployed and overworked and not respected in a country that we all came to for work. All my grandparents came to America for one reason, for work and freedom, but mostly work. And work in America is horrific. There is nobody, nobody has a job in America where they're happy. They're all miserable.
Well, and that's your endorsement of Bernie Sanders, ladies and gentlemen. And that's why David Feldman, hereby, say it out loud. Go ahead. Make the announcement.
I support Bernie Sanders because America has fallen prey to greed on Wall Street. And you're all miserable, America, whether you know it or not. You're miserable because you don't have time for recreation. You don't have time for your family. When you are with your family or with your loved ones, you're worried about your job. Your phone is ringing. You're getting emails from your job. You're convinced every second of your life that you can be replaced with the push of a button. And you can be replaced with the push of a button because we can all be replaced. That's why unions were invented. Nobody's indispensable. Nobody, including the people who run Wall Street. Everybody can be replaced. So let's replace the people on Wall Street and put some laws into place where work does not consume your entire life. I mean, we're working longer hours for less money. We're more productive. And yet we live under this sort of Damocles that we're going to get fired. We're one paycheck away from bankruptcy. What kind of country is this when Vice President Joe Biden's son dies from cancer and Joe Biden has to, he's the Vice President of the United States and he's talking to President Obama about selling his house to help pay for Beau Biden's medical expenses? What country are we living in when the Vice President of the United States has to consider selling his own house because his son died from a brain tumor and his son's family doesn't have enough money to get their kids through college? This is a sick country, and it's made diseased by the greed on Wall Street. And only one person is addressing that, and that's Bernie Sanders. We can't have more of the same. We can't. Nobody has a job. If you're getting paid to do something, you're miserable. And I invite anybody who's listening to challenge me on that. I challenge anyone to tell me that they have a job, a paycheck, and happiness. They don't. And it used to be this way in our country. Because we had dignity. We had dignity in this country. We had a middle class that had power and dignity, and we have been robbed of our dignity in this country. If I'm paying you, I own your soul. That's what Wall Street says to the working man. And I'm goddamn sick of it. Hello?
Wow. Wow.
And I don't want more of the same. All right. Vote for Bernie Sanders, New Hampshire. Will Durst has been called quite possibly the
greatest. Go to willdurst.com. Follow me on Twitter, Facebook, like, blah, blah. Who do you do? I got to go, buddy. I got to run to the store.
Thank you, Will Durst.
Hey.
I love you.
Have fun. Have a fun New Hampshire.
And come to
the primary. And it's Mardi Gras.
Yes.
And I'm appearing at 142 Throckmorton. So it's three things in one. It's like...
Are you Throckmorton tonight?
Yeah.
Are you going to see Mort Saul?
No, he's on Thursday.
Mort Saul's at the Throckmorton Thursday night?
Every Thursday.
Every Thursday he's at the Throckmorton?
Yeah, and he's
in Mill Valley?
He's streaming it on Periscope, so you can watch it every Thursday.
I got to get him back on the show. I got to get more. All right. I love you, Will Durst.
I love you, David Feldman.
Okay.
Thank you for your passion, buddy.
Thank you. Bye. That's Will Durst, willdurst.com. You can read him in the Progressive Magazine every month. Go see him at a theater near you, Elect to Laugh 2016, his one-man show. The Throckmorton Theater in Mill Valley is amazing. It's right over the Golden Gate Bridge. It's God's country. So if you're ever visiting San Francisco, go to the Throckmorton. It's where Mort Saul hangs out. I will be at the Creek in the Cave, February 17th through the 21st at 7 p.m. with the amazing John Fugelsang and the incredible Frank Conniff. For more information, go to thecreekinthecave.com. Tickets are either $5 or $10. I don't know. But either way, it's definitely worth it. And Frank Conniff, John Fugelsang, and I are going to be doing more and more shows together. And we just did a great benefit at Union Hall in Brooklyn, which was sold out. And we did a benefit for Bernie Sanders. It was Saturday night at Union Hall. We sold it out. And I think we raised $1,000 for Bernie. We raised $1,000 for Bernie Sanders. And we're going to Atlantic City tomorrow, Alex and I, to see if we can double it at the craps. No, it's going directly to Bernie Sanders after I get my cut. I'm kidding. It's all going to Bernie Sanders. The Triumph Election special is on Hulu. I strongly urge you to watch this. It's some of the funniest political satire that's ever been performed. From the show, friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Amazon. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage. Become a monthly subscriber for $5 a month. Gain access to all our premium content from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.